I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome to our service today. We thank God because of this privilege he has given to us to share in his word. I would like to begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Our Lord and our God, we are grateful because of who you are and because of the Father that you have brought us. Thank you, Lord, because you reign eternal. Thank you, Lord, because you're sovereign. Thank you, Lord, because of everything that you have granted to us by your grace. And even as we grapple with the truths as presented in your word, we ask that, Lord, you may guide us and be with us for the glory and honor of your name. In Christ's name I pray and give thanks. Amen. I would like to encourage us with a hymn, with a psalm from the book of Psalm 8, Psalms chapter 8. And this is what the Bible says. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place. What is man that you're mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, and the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. Our Lord, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. I would like to invite the worship team to lead us in a few songs.
Praise the Lord, church. I trust that we're all doing well. I'd like to challenge you to arise even in your home, to get up on your feet as we praise the Lord with this song called Kwa Matendo.
Me.
kila siku. Amen. Na kwa sababu ya hiyo tunataka kuwa wimbo unaosema kuwa yeye ndiye anayetosha.
Our Lord and our God, we are grateful to you because there is none like you. From the bottom of our hearts, Lord, we cry that you reign eternal, that you are sovereign, O God, that there is none that can stand beside or before thee. There is none to compare to you. We thank you, Lord, because of the gift of life, because of what you have graciously granted to us, because of the gift of salvation, because of enabling us to see a new day, O Lord, because of keeping us safe, O Lord. We thank you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you have done. You who made the heavens and the earth by the power of your word, O Lord, we submit to your authority. We cry from the depths of our hearts that, Lord, we are in dire need of you. We cry that, Lord, we are in great need for you, O God. We pray that, Lord, you would visit us in this period of calamity when people are wondering what would come next, when our hearts are anxious, Lord, not forgetting your word that says that we should not be anxious about anything, But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, we present our requests known to you. And the peace of God that transcends human understanding will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. We ask that, Lord, you may help us to rest easy on you, to rely fully on you, O God, to trust in you, to run to you, just like your word says that your name is a strong tower where the righteous run into it and they are safe. Oh Lord, we pray that this particular period may teach us things about you that we never would have learned otherwise. We ask that, Lord, you may help us to be able to understand that you are the one who sustains everything by your power. Help us, Lord, to grapple with the truths that this world is under your sole authority. Help us, Lord, to comprehend the fact that there is nothing that can compare to you. I commit those people that are struggling in these times, O Lord. Some of our people lack food. Some of the people don't know where to get the next meal. Others have been laid off from their work. We ask that, Lord, you may intervene, O God. Because this is a cry of our helplessness. This is our cry of our inability to sort ourselves. This is a cry of our total dependence on you. And we ask that, Lord, you may come through for us. Not only for provision of food, but so that we may learn that you are Lord and there is none like you. Not only for us to have jobs, but that we may learn that you are God that provides. That every time we may run to you, that we may depend on you solely on for everything in our lives. May you be with our families. May you be with those people that are struggling, even in their marriages at this particular time. I ask that, Lord, you may bless them, that, Lord, you may continue teaching them, that, Lord, your church and your people may learn that you are God and there is none like you. Oh, Lord, may you use this particular period to minister to those people that do not know you. We pray and we cry that they may see what is happening in this world, and they may turn their hearts towards you. And they may learn that there is nothing that you can't do. They may learn that you are God. They may learn that you are the one who puts everything in place. They may learn that you're the one who holds everything together for the glory and honor of your name. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen.
We would like to sing the song Ancient Words, even as we welcome the pastor to come and share the sermon.
Guide us home, ancient ones.
Once again, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm grateful to God because of this privilege he has given to us to share in his word, his living and enduring and perfect word. We thank God for the privilege of life and for everything that he has graciously granted us. I want to continue from where I stopped last time, just talking about who our God is. This period must teach us more about God, must challenge us to draw nearer to God, must tell us or make us understand things about God that maybe we wouldn't have ever understood otherwise. And what better way to understand about God than to go to his word? There is no better way to understand him than to seek him through his word. So today we are going to look at Psalm chapter 93 from verse 1 to 5 under the theme, Clothed in Majesty. All talking about our God and who he is and how majestic he is and how much we must draw near to him, how much we must be challenged to worship him, to serve him, because we are under his sovereign reign. So I will read Psalm 93, and then we will share briefly from God's word. Psalm chapter 93, the Bible says, "The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their roaring. Mightier than the thunders of many waters, mightier than the waters of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Your decrees are very trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, furthermore." I'm going to do three things. One, I'm going to talk about the proclamation of the king's majesty that is found in verse 1 and verse 2. Secondly, I'm going to look at the king's power amidst storm. That is in verse 3 and 4. And finally, I'll talk about the perfection of the king's decrees. Number one is the proclamation of the king's majesty in verse 1 and in verse 2. Number two is the king's power amidst the storm, verse 3 and 4. And number three, the perfection of the king's decrees that is found in verse 5. I remember a quote by Dr. R.C. Sproul, where he says, "Every truth, every doctrine of the scriptures must be understood in light of the truth of God himself. Every truth, every doctrine of the scriptures must be understood in light of the truth of God himself." Like I told you the last time, that everything about God's word or everything in the scriptures is all about who is God. From the creation to the book of Revelation, from Genesis to Revelation, everything is all about God. The scriptures talk about him. And therefore, if we are to understand the Bible, if we are to understand the things that are written in God's word, we must understand them in light of the character of God. Who is God and what is his character? What is his nature? We must know things about God that are true, and that will help us to understand every given doctrine of the Bible. And that is why he would say that every truth, every doctrine of the scripture must be understood in light of the truth of God himself. Every time when you're reading your Bible, you must ask yourself, how does this scripture help me understand more about God? Or how is God presented in this particular portion of scripture? Because all scriptures speak about him. speak about a sovereign God. If we want to understand creation, we must understand creation in light of who God is. If we want to understand the fall of man, we must understand the fall of man in light of who God is. If we want to understand redemption, it must be understood in light of who God is. If we want to understand doctrine of justification, sanctification, providence, and every other doctrine in the Bible, it must be understood in the light of who God is. And one foundational truth, or the fundamental truth of who God is, is that God is sovereign. God is eternal. God is powerful. God is mighty. And we will do well to trust and rely on Him. All the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation produce this fact, that God is sovereign, that God is eternal, that He has a plan, that He runs the world, that He controls everything that happens in the world. And we must trust Him. That's the foundation. That's the foundation of everything that has been written in scriptures. Everything speaks about Him and His majesty. And therefore today we pray that the Lord would help us to understand that He is sovereign, that He reigns eternal, that He is majestic, that He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And for us to understand that, we must seek Him from His word. We can never understand who God really is out of His word. God has spoken to us through His word, and if we have to understand Him, we must understand Him in light of His word. As Christians, we must learn to be nice and good students of the Word of God. We must read it. We must meditate on it. That's why Joshua was told, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night. Why was he told this? So that he may be careful to observe the things that are written in it. The truths about God are revealed in His word. And we can never understand who He really is if we don't go to His word. Therefore, Christians, this is a good time to study more about God. This is a good time to interact more with God. And you'll realize that the more you interact with God, the more you learn about Him, the more humble you become, the more you want to preach His word, the more you want to share these truths that you learn in His word with other people that may not have learned as much as you have. And so, this is the foundational truth of my preaching, of the scriptures, that the Lord is sovereign and in control. And the reason why we are talking about the sovereignty of God is we are living in a time where people would question the very existence of God based on the things that are happening, based on the deaths of people, based on the number of people dying daily, based on how hard this calamity has struck. People would question the very existence of God. And as Christians, we must emphatically proclaim that our God is sovereign, that our God exists, that our God is powerful, that our God is King. That must be a truth that should be implanted in our hearts, that we should never at any point doubt this truth, that our Lord is sovereign. And therefore, the proclamation of the King's majesty, Psalm 93, it begins, "The Lord reigns." A statement of truth. There is no shadow of a doubt on who reigns. There is no question about who is king. The answer is that the Lord is king. The Lord reigns. He created this earth by the power of His word. He runs the affairs of the earth. He has everything about us figured out. We are His creatures. He is the King. He is the Lord. He is the Creator. Therefore, the psalmist would proclaim that the Lord reigns. The picture here is the picture of a king exercising authority over his subjects. And God is the King. We are His subjects. And it is the work of a subject to submit to the reigning king, the sitting king. And this time we are talking about an eternal king, a king who reigns eternal, a king whose reign will never end. We are talking about one who is clothed in majesty. He says, the Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. Picture of a garment. The Lord is robed in majesty. He is majestic. There is none that can compare to him. The word majesty shows impressive beauty. The Lord reigns. The Lord is sovereign. Remember last time I told you that sovereignty is the attribute of God, which he has a right and the freedom to do whatsoever he pleases, whenever he pleases, however he pleases, in respect to whomever he pleases, which is always in harmony with his being, his holiness, his wisdom, his justice, and his truth. Therefore, the psalmist would come and say, the Lord reigns. Why? Because he reigns. And this is a fundamental truth, that our Lord, the God that we serve, is a king. The God that we serve exercises dominion. The God that we serve is sovereign, and he reigns. And we are his subjects. Every born-again, blood-washed saint is a member of his kingdom. We are his subjects. The Lord is majestic, and this picture is given in the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. When Isaiah, and this is what the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood seraphims. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. A statement of proclamation, a proclamation of a truth, that holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. The whole earth is full of his glory because he is the Lord who reigns. He is the Lord who is king. The psalmist continues and says, the Lord is robed. He has put strength as his belt. Not only is God king, but he is a powerful king. He has put strength as his belt. He is the all-powerful. There is no power that can compare to his power. He is the all-knowing. He is the ever-present God. He is the God that is there. Even as we face this calamity, we must remember that our God is present, that our God is powerful, that our God is sovereign. And he has a reason why he has allowed this pandemic to strike. There are some spiritual lessons and some lessons that we must learn through everything that God does. And every Christian must be able to learn truths about God. Even when he is faced with calamities, there are things that we must learn about God. But one foundational truth is that the Lord reigns, that he is king. We are his subjects. When a king gives an order, the subjects follow. Why? Because this is the order from the king, the reigning king. The Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. We trust and we serve a sovereign God. We trust and we serve a God who has strength, a God who is all powerful. There is no power in heaven and on earth and under the earth that can compare to his. Therefore, as we serve him, as we live for him, as we face challenges, we must understand that we are under the sovereign arms of God. We are under a king who is powerful, a king who is all-knowing, a king who is almighty. And he continues and says, yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. The world is established, and the picture here is based on the fact that the king created and maintains the world. God is the one who has created the world, and he created the world by the power of his word. He said, let there be, and there was. Sometimes we are not even struck by the reality of who God is. A God who would speak things into existence, who would create something out of nothing, who would say, let there be light, and there would be light. That's the God that we serve. That's the God that we trust in. The God who sustains everything. He not only created the world, but he's the one who sustains the world by his power. There is nothing that can happen in this world that is outside his control. We must understand that there is nothing that can happen outside his control. There is nothing that can happen outside his reign. There is nothing that catches our Lord God by surprise. Even this calamity did not catch him by surprise. He knows how it will end. He knows what is coming next. And he knows everything. And as his subject who trust in him, we will do well to rely fully on him. We will do well to sink ourselves or to soak ourselves under his authority. We would do well for ourselves if we relied on him for everything. If we sought him, this is a good time for Christians to be on their knees, to cry to God for help, to cry to God for sustenance. Because he's the God who created everything and he's the God who has established the world and it shall never be moved. The reason why the world shall never be moved is because it has been established by a God who is immovable. It has been established by a God who is eternal. It has been established by a God who is sovereign. A God who is never threatened by any circumstance or anything that happens. In verse 2, the psalmist says, your throne is established from old and you are from everlasting. The throne of God is established and God is everlasting. God has no beginning. He's the very definition of beginning and the end. He has no beginning and no end. There is no meaning for the word beginning apart from him. He is the very epitome of beginning and end. He is the very, he is everlasting. He reigns eternal. He is eternal God. And when we trust in him, we know what awaits us. We know that he has a good plan for us. We know what he will do. We know that he is powerful. We know that he can do everything that he wants to do. We know that he will do everything that he has said he will do. Therefore, as Christians, we must trust in him. For those people who are feeling discouraged, for those people who feel like the world is ending, for those people who feel like everything is coming to a standstill, please know that the Lord reigns, that his reign is everlasting. There are people who are speculating that the world is coming to an end, and every Christian must rejoice in that fact. The world is coming to an end. We say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. The second coming of Jesus Christ should not scare any believer. In fact, we should wait eagerly for his coming. Why? Because his coming means that we reign with him. His reign, his throne is established from old. You are from everlasting. This shows rulership. This shows power. This shows leadership. This shows sovereignty. This shows a God who's not moved. This shows a God who's steadfast. A God who's powerful. A God who's strong. We would do well to believe and to trust in him. The king's power amidst the storm, verse 3 and 4. This is what the Bible says in verse 3. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voices. The floods lift up their roaring. This lifting up of floods is a picture of chaos, a picture of calamity. That even though the psalmist has given us a foundational truth about God, he does not negate the fact that even though God reigns, there is existence of calamity in the world. And calamity strikes in the world because the sovereign king allows it to strike. For his own good, for his own purpose. Remember, I told you that everything must be understood in light of the truth of who God is. We must understand everything in light of who he is. And if there is calamity in the world, we must understand that it is God who has allowed it to happen. It is God who has allowed it to happen. And as Christians, many times we ask the question, why? We may never know why the Lord has allowed these things to happen. The question that we should ask, rather than asking the question why, is how much, oh Lord, teach me as much, or the thing that we should embrace is this concept, that is this knowledge, that teach me as much as you would want me to learn through this circumstance. Everything that a Christian goes through, their attitude must be, teach me, O Lord. Teach me more about you. Help me grow, get closer to you. Help me learn a lot more about you than I have. Help me learn about you. And even when the calamity strikes, because the psalmist is saying, the floods have lifted up. There is chaos, there is calamity, there is destruction. And no wonder the book of James chapter 1, the Bible shows us that we shall never, that the Christian life or life on this side of eternity is full of calamity. What should be our attitude towards these floods lifting up, towards the chaos, towards everything that is coming? What should be our attitude towards this? James says in the book of James chapter 1 from verse 2 to 4, and he says this, "Count it all joy, my brothers. Count it all joy. Be joyful." Why or when should we be joyful? When you meet trials of various kinds. And the command of the Lord is that we should count it all joy when we meet trials of various kinds. In the midst of distress, even though we would be distressed in our lives, even though we would wonder what will come next, even though sometimes in our weaknesses we would be anxious, the Bible commands us to count it all joy when we go through trials, that we should be joyful, that we should be joyful when we go through trials, that we should be encouraged in the Lord. Why should we be joyful when we go through trials? James continues by saying, "For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness." Some other version says that faith, that it produces perseverance. The testing of your faith produces perseverance. We must be able to learn to trust in God. We must be able to learn to persevere. God must teach us to persevere. The journey from Egypt to Israel was a short journey, but it took them 40 years. And the children of Israel must have learned perseverance. We must wait upon the Lord. When we think that the Lord is far away from us, we must remember Abraham. By the time he was promised that he would have a son, it took him 25 years before he actually got a son. We must remember Moses. By the time he was called by God, he was 40. By the time he was going to deliver the children of Israel from captivity, he was 80. He had a 40-year wait. We must remember that even though God elected the nation Israel, even though God chose the Israelites, he put them in captivity for 70 years. Not forgetting the fact that they were in Egypt for 430 years. They must have learned perseverance. Whenever we cry and grumble before God, when we are going through tough times, we claim that we are better than them. Are we better than the children of Israel? Are we better than Abraham, who persevered and waited upon the Lord? We must wait upon the Lord. We must persevere. And he continues, James continues and says, "And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." That the things that we go through, the calamities that we face, are supposed to help us, to equip us, to furnish us, so that we may not be lacking in anything. You will never understand that God is a provider if you've never gone hungry. You'll never understand that God is a protector if you've never been in instances or in situations that needed protection. You'd never understand that God is a healer if you've never been sick. You'd never understand things about God if you never went through the things that you have gone through. Therefore, we must embrace those things that come our way, knowing that we are under a sovereign king. We are under the Lord God Almighty, who reigns eternal and is supreme and is not shaken. But we must go through this knowing that God is modeling us, God is molding us, God is transforming us into his image. And that's why I like saying that all things work together for good for them that are called, are loved by the Lord and called according to his purpose. The ultimate good of every Christian is that they will be glorified, that they will be more like Christ, that everything that happens in our lives will be geared towards making us more like Christ. Therefore, we must patiently endure. Those that have been laid off, some of us have been laid off. Some of us have no food to eat. We must endure. In as much as we trust God, we must endure. We must know that there is something that the Lord is teaching us. There is something that he is teaching us through these things. And if you ask many of us, on so many occasions we've gone without food. On so many occasions we've gone without a proper place to live in. But our God has still remained God, and he has still remained faithful. Therefore, we must Rely on him fully. Verse 4 says, mightier than the hundreds of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. The encouragement here amidst these storms that are must in the life of Christians is that God is mightier than the storms. God is mightier than the waves. God is mightier than anything that would come our way. If it is calamity, we must understand that our God is mightier than the calamity. We must understand that God is mightier than anything we may face. The comfort in it, the comfort in going through trials, is that we understand that we are under a God who is mightier than the things that we go through. A God who has allowed us to go through those things. Remember the story of Job and the things that he went through. He went through a lot. He went through a lot. But he was under the arms of the mighty God. Our God is mightier than all those things, mightier than hundreds of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea. Oh, the Lord on high is mighty. Therefore, he has a good plan. He has a good reason why he would let us go through whatever we are going through. We have no right to grumble and complain before a holy God. We have been exhorted by the scriptures that we must continue relying and trusting on him. Finally, the perfection of the king's decrees. The Bible says in verse 5, your decrees are trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, furthermore. Even though there would be waves, even though there would be calamity, even though there would be chaos in this world, we must know that the Lord is king and that his decrees are trustworthy. How do we find the decrees, or where do we find the decrees of the Lord? In his living and enduring and perfect word. That's why he said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will remain. That's why his words are sure. That's why his words are everlasting. That's why heaven and that's why his words are eternal. And the psalmist says here, your decrees are trustworthy. We must trust in the living and enduring and perfect word of God. Because God is trustworthy, God is faithful. Even when we go through these times, there is no situation that is permanent. No permanent situation in human life. But our God is trustworthy. Holiness befits his house. He is trustworthy and separate, because the word holy means separate. Our God Almighty is trustworthy and holy, separate. Not like human beings who would tell you one thing and mean the next. Not like people who would lie to you. Our God says whatever he means whatever he says, and says whatever he means. Your decrees are trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8, this is what the Bible says. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. We have an eternal God who has given us his word that will stand forever. Therefore, where should Christians run for comfort? Comfort in a Christian life should be found in the living and enduring and perfect word of God. We must submit to his word. We must submit to this Lord who is king, who is majestic, who is eternal, who is sovereign, who is powerful, who reigns forever and ever. I would like to encourage you. I don't know what you're going through. We have a God who is mightier than anything that you may ever face in this life. We have a God who has a plan for your life. We have a God who is holy and eternal. We have a God who has given us his word that endures forever. We will do well to believe and to trust in him. Let us pray. Our Lord and our God, we thank you because of your word. Thank you, Father, because you are the King who is majestic. Thank you because your word is sure and steadfast. I ask that, Lord, you may help us to understand things about you that we know and believe are true. Help us, Lord, to believe in your word. Help us, Lord, to run to you in these times. Help us, Lord, to submit ourselves to you. For the glory and honor of your name, in Christ's name I pray and give thanks. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Silas, for that word on the sovereignty of God. Actually, our God is a great God and a mighty God who cannot be questioned, and He does things as He wills. So it's time to give, and we're going to sing a hymn as we give. I'll call Kathoni to do so. But before she comes, you can give through our pay bill number that appears on the screen. The Lord will bless you. Then on top of that, you can also visit the church office to come over and bring goods that would help the needy in our midst. Amen.
We thank the Lord. Thank you, Pastor, for sharing with us. The exhortation for us this morning has been to trust in God through it all, to question our souls when they're downcast, for them to put their trust in the Lord. Only so shall we find thousands of reasons to be able to bless the Lord.
Sing like
Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Amen. May the Lord keep you. May he guide you. May he lead you. May he help you to trust in him for the glory and honor of his name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.